one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did the sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen. Serenity prayer is a common prayer that's written by American theologian Ryan Wiebe and adopted and popularized by Alcoholics Anonymous and some other 12-step programs. I first heard this prayer when I took a team from Central United Church here to Nicaragua way back in 2002, fall, and this was a very special team. At that time, I don't know if they still have it, the Central United Church here in Calgary had an evening service called the Recovery Service, and every evening, it was a Sunday night service, I believe, and one of the pastors would get up onto the stool in front of everyone there and said, "Hi, my name is Michael or Al, whatever his name was. I'm an alcoholic." He was. And everyone just shouted, "Hi, Al." And this was the team I took to Nicaragua. There is something about hanging out with self-identified addicts, recovering addicts. It's something unique to be around. Every morning on that trip, we would stand in the corner. We were sleeping in these mosquito tents in this village community center, and there was a courtyard there, and we would all hold hands. There were 25 of us. These guys, domestics are here this morning. You were on that trip. You actually were on that trip with your honeymoon. Yes. Welcome here this morning. Wow. Who knows? Say hello to the domestics this morning. Welcome here. Do you remember this? We'd stand in the courtyard holding hands and say the first part of that prayer, which they've shortened and says, "God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference." And then there would be a little talk after that. We'd go on to the day. That's how we started every one of our days together. Now, at the end of the trip, I got to know the people on this trip quite well, and they were very special. It was interesting because very independent group. We had a work project and some other things going on, medical clinics and other things. Especially on the work project, that team would have to walk through the community to go to the work project. Very few would actually make it to the work project. They would end up in the coffee shop or the pool hall to just pull out their Spanish English dictionary and start hanging out. And to them, they taught me that relationships were more important than the project would get done. And the local people actually recognized that you loved them. At the end of the trip, they gave me a book. Something that is a prized possession to me today, this book right here. It is the big book, the Alcoholics Anonymous book, written by Bill Wilson and Dr. Bob back in 1935. And you can't actually see the title on it. I don't know if that's where it's supposed to be, or it's been so used to torn off. Now, they presented this to me at the end, and they said, "Just in case you fall off the wagon cliff," right? And little did they know, I already had fallen off the wagon. Not with alcohol, but with another addiction. At that point, what I would have been addicted to would have been success and pleasing others. It was really quite all-consuming to me at Samaritan's First, where I worked at that time. It was workaholism. It comes quite naturally to me. point in my life, I was on a five-year journey to destruction, really. 4 years into my work there and my fast-paced lifestyle, Heather, my wife, asked me to leave. I worked with Americans First and it took me another year to do it. Now, this is not Americans First. They're a phenomenal organization. But in the name of ministry, I was just I've been here. A series on Netflix that you can't turn off. Boy, what's next? No, Netflix. Is that little, the next episode will play in 8 seconds? That's neat. Click. Oh, there goes another hour. Oh, click. There goes another hour. Like, who came up with that one? Okay, evil. But delight. What makes us push that? Next hour. Not good. Okay? Now, so here. This is feels good. Tingling feels good. General desire, I want it. And the will is that moment just before I do. Okay. This guy here, he's a soldier. He can be weak or he can be strong. We all have him in our life. Lieutenant Will. So, soldier. Is he weak or strong? It makes a difference, but it doesn't make the total difference. Now, above the whole heart hierarchy we have here is something called reason. What is reason taking into? He calls this your royal temptation. Should I do this or shouldn't I do this? Temptation comes along. If you just go with these guys, it's not going to end up well. You're going to get it. Oh, what? That feels good. I'm going to click that, Netflix next episode button in a heartbeat. But reason, if I stop, I have to go to work the next day. Okay? I have to get up in the morning, 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock meeting. I'm watching this until midnight. That's not good. That's reason coming into play on a Netflix situation. When does it win and when doesn't it win? Why does it win when with temptation? Reason is this. These are your beliefs, our beliefs. And so here's the thing. What we just read about in 1 Corinthians and then in 2 Peter about righteousness, happens right here. I have to make a conscious decision to come away from the Lord. Trust in Him, and He will do this. He will make your righteousness shine like the dawn, and the justice of your cause like the noonday sun. So you work on this. It takes effort. I think so many, like, really, when we read this verse in 1 Corinthians, God will make a way out. And I was thinking, man, God, do something. But that's me standing on the sidelines of a game, looking in, saying, God, make that different. What He's saying is, Cliff, get in the game. I can't help you if you're on the sideline. You got to get in the game. You got to work on your mind. You got to work on understanding. You got to work on your relationship with Me for this to make a difference here. I think we think, God, supernaturally, You're going to make a way out for me. Sometimes, yeah. Most times, no. Not without some work on our part. Actually, a lot of work on our part. Have you ever had it out with addicts? It is so hard. Have you ever wrestled with, you have, we all have, wrestled with the sin? It is so hard to overcome. But with God, it can be done. And righteousness, not sinlessness, we all will continue to struggle. Even in Hebrews 11, when you have your list of all the people who are righteous and that were in that list, still very broken people, but God saw their hearts and saw their longing for Him, and it was righteous. Now, there's some things here that are long-term. This is long-term work. Building this, building this. Sometimes we are not ready for what's going to happen to us in the moment. Now, working on this really will help us. When King Delight, and we will also have this morning, no matter how hard we work on this, King Delight says, Royal Council, I'm not going to ask you right now. Okay, I'm not going to ask you right now. King Delight is not looking to the Royal Council for any help. And he's not giving it at that moment. And you just want to follow this. One word, maybe a couple, but one word said a few different ways. Run. It really is that simple. Like, theologically, I know deep, I know, but run. Flee. The Bible talks about fleeing temptation, running from it. It's like Joseph and Delilah. Joseph and Potiphar's wife, household. When she's going after him, he runs. The opposite is true for David on top of the tower, or top of his palace, looking out over the city. He shouldn't have even been there. Kings were supposed to be out at war. He was in